For today, we have two fantastic speakers, but before we get started, I wanted to make a couple quick announcements. For those of you that did not notice or may have noticed, you can get a copy of Danielle's new book, Better Now, Six Big Ideas to Improve Healthcare for All Canadians. It is out front. It is $30 cash, cash and carry, so there is no additional charges. You can pay cash or credit card out front. It will be available after the event as well. And as always, these events are not possible without the support of our sponsors. So supporting today is IBM. I think I saw Paul out here today, Paul Salkers. As well, we have a Medtronic, and did Pam make it? I don't know if Pam Windsor made it or not this morning. We also have PwC is supporting today, and of course, the Canadian Foundation for Healthcare Improvement. And our facility graciously supported us, so Sinai Health Systems. I would now like to invite our speakers and introduce them, Danielle Martin, Dr. Danielle Martin, and Maureen O'Neill.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks, Matt. Danielle, you have been on the road for 11 weeks talking about better healthcare now in Canada. Tell us a little bit about what's in the book. We don't want to tell everything because we'd like people to buy it. But mostly, what did Canadians say? You've probably talked to more Canadians about improving healthcare than anybody since Roy Romano.
I think it's actually true. And it's been a remarkable experience. You know, of course, as is natural, I suppose, I focused so much on the work of getting this book written and out the door that I did not really have a whole lot of intellectual clarity about what the purpose of the book tour process was going to be, other than obviously trying to sell books. And it has turned out to be actually a life-altering and perspective-altering experience for me. So I'm glad to have the opportunity to tell you a little bit about it. The reason that I wrote the book in the first place is because I think I had come to feel, as I know you and many others have come to feel, that the conversation about healthcare in Canada had become so stale, and it was such a rinse and repeat kind of a conversation that you sort of felt that, you know, with the greatest of respect to our political leadership, that, you know, before the premiers and the prime minister or the ministers of health ever even touched tarmac in Ottawa, you could kind of predict what that conversation was going to look like. And so many of the conferences that we were all going to were kind of revolving around the same themes. And the public conversation could essentially be distilled down to this binary kind of either Medicare is perfect and there's nothing wrong with it at all and we shouldn't touch anything about it, or it's a disaster, it's fundamentally broken, it's unsustainable, and the sky is going to fall as the baby boomers age. And it was a really depressing frame, I think, for public conversation, with the result that I think citizens have become less and less engaged in the conversation. So the purpose of the book was to try to change the channel on the conversation in the public domain. This is not a book that is geared towards academics or healthcare system leaders, although, you know, it's well researched and cited, et cetera. It is a book for Canadians, and it's an attempt to try to change the channel on the conversation from this, less talk about whether our healthcare system is good or bad, more talk about how to make it better. And I focus very much on narrative in the book. It's full of stories, true stories of my own patients, my own family, patients of colleagues, and others traveling through the system to illustrate for people where the system is working, where it is not, how people are falling through the cracks and gaps, and most importantly, what we can do about it. Because I think to focus on the elements in our healthcare systems that are challenging for people to try to navigate without offering any of the evidence-informed solutions that are available to us is a downer, frankly. And I'm just not interested in having that kind of, contributing to that kind of conversation. So I went on the tour. I've been to, I think, 13 cities in the last number of weeks, all over the country, met with, as you say, I mean, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. And there were some things that I expected. So I expected that people would share their stories. and they have, and that's been, I feel like I could staple together my inbox emails and it would be another book, frankly. Both beautiful stories about people's tremendously positive experiences in the healthcare system, and also stuff that would just break your heart, and which I think many of you in the room could probably imagine what some of those stories look like. The one that sticks with me the most is the guy who emailed me to say, I feel that the Canadian healthcare system has saved my life twice, both when I had a heart attack and when I developed a cancer diagnosis, and I'm incredibly grateful. But I can't eat solid food because after the chemotherapy, my mouth has been full of chronic sores and my teeth are falling out and I can't afford to see a dentist. Do you know a dentist who might be willing to put me on a payment plan? And so, you know, I'm getting these daily now because what happens when you put yourself out there is people come to you with their questions, with their personal problems that they need help with. I had not anticipated that I was going to basically have a case management job on the side, but there is some of that that goes on, right? And you have to honor what people are bringing to you in that circumstance, and it's a heavy burden. So that I was not totally prepared for. The last thing that I would say intellectually I knew or hoped perhaps that it was going to happen, but clearly I was completely unprepared for was the book club of retired nurses who came to my Ottawa book launch with their copies of Better Now under their arms. It reminded me of, Our Bodies Ourselves in the early days, right? They came with their copy of Better Now under their arms with sticky notes in it, and they said to me, we've read it, we agree with your big ideas, we want to support it, what can we do? And I was, honored, obviously, but I was totally ill-equipped to answer that question. And so that's why, to me, what this conversation I'm hoping is the beginning of is a little bit of a crowdsourcing exercise on trying to answer that question, because actually what I have learned is that people are interested in this issue about how to make the healthcare system better, and they are willing to participate. But we need to figure out, we collectively as a healthcare community need to figure out what opportunities we're going to give them to do that beyond sort of, well, come and sit on a hospital committee or that sort of thing. And I don't think that we have done that effectively until now, which may be part of the reason why making change has been hard. So I am hoping to get out of this interaction with you and this group today a better answer to that question.
Actually, I think I've got to join the retired nurses book club, because look at my copy. Like, I've got all those little sections marked off in different colors. We do hope that we will be able to imagine together how a really community-rooted discussion about improving Canadian healthcare could actually happen. I suggested to Danielle that, in fact, she, if not write another book on it, at least classify the kinds of emails that are coming in, because it's very, very rare that anybody goes out with a book like this. I mean, when I think of Harvey Lazar's Paradigm Freeze, which was, I think that was the title, which was an excellent book, but I don't think, it might have made the rounds of academic conferences, but it did not make the rounds of public meetings and television. And it's your television appearances and talking about what you have said in this book that really provides a basis for having a broader public discussion. Now, we wanted to talk about just a couple of things this morning. One was primary care. We agreed that in Canada, if you look at the Commonwealth Fund comparisons, Canadians are complaining about access to both primary care, even if they have a doctor, and also to specialist consults. We're actually at the bottom of the developed world on those two points. But how do you get your hands around primary care? Because we don't actually have a management structure. So what would we actually do about that?
So the first thing is that in the book, what I try to do, so the first big idea is relationship-based primary health care for every single Canadian. And I try to invite people to imagine, to aim higher than just being able to say, I have a family doctor or a primary care team or a nurse practitioner who I identify as my person. Because actually, our stats are not bad on that front. 85% of Canadians now report that they have a regular place of care, usually a family physician who they see, and that number is closer to 95% for people who have one or more chronic illnesses. So people are attached, in quotes. But as you've identified, A, when you call the office for an appointment, chances are 50-50 that you're not going to be able to get an appointment in the next 48 hours. And B, I think that we don't have data, but I suspect it would not, you know, be particularly terrific to if we were to ask people about the relationship that they have with that individual. And so I go into some depth around the evidence for relationship-based primary care, because it's my view that all of the other things that we want and need to do in terms of improving the healthcare system by making access to specialists much more, you know, utilizing centralized intake more, utilizing virtual care more, and all of these other kinds of system-wide things where people will experience a much more standardized, but perhaps less of a human touch kind of a feel in other parts of the healthcare system. None of that works if you're not grounded in a trusting, caring relationship with a primary care provider who knows you. And if you feel seen and supported in primary care, then that's the beginning and the end of all of the other things that we need to do for the improvement of the healthcare system. But as you identify, it's really hard because we don't have a receptor site or an infrastructure for moving primary care along in the healthcare system. I actually think, I mean, of course, team-based care, it's sort of almost trite to say, but for sure, in traveling across the country and seeing how variously advanced or not advanced the move towards team-based care has been across the country, it is clear to me that in those provinces where team-based care in the primary care sector has been embraced, everything else is going much better. So for sure, that is part of it. Also, in the act of building teams, one develops an infrastructure. But the last thing I want to say is something that I actually learned from the experience of HealthLinks here in Ontario, and from Pauline Pariser, who heads up our HealthLink, which is that fundamentally, the work in primary care is community organizing work. That is what it is. And if we start to actually use the tools of community organizing, then we will do much better. Structural changes, you know, are important, but unless you do the community organizing, local engagement kind of work, it's going to be very hard, particularly outside of Ontario. I think I met Nova Scotia, where I just was, for example. It's almost impossible to do it any other way.
Exactly, and I hope we can come back to examples like HealthLinks later, because we still have a huge problem of siloed budgets, which make it impossible in many places, even with the best will in the world, to have integrated care across across disciplines, some of whom are not even covered by Medicare.
Right.
Now, access to specialists is where Canada is also right at the bottom of the heap. And the Canadian Foundation for Healthcare Improvement has a very interesting collaborative that's just launched on access, where we put together what was learned in British Columbia through their RACE program. And you've talked about RACE in the book, Rapid Access to Consultative Expertise. And the approach that Dr. Claire Liddy has begun in Champlain, in the Champlain-Lynn, that does a very similar thing, but accessing through the computer. I know that my GP says she uses that system in Ontario about 9 times a day. So what does this mean? It means that GPs actually connect with, using the clever technology of the telephone in British Columbia, and the specialist talks to the GP and says, no, I think what you're doing with Mr. Smith looks fine, or not. And they reduced massively the need for in-person consultations. So it's not impossible to improve, as your book says. It's just that we have to do it. And similarly, in with Claire's work and eBase, both The same thing. That's what we learn. It's very, very possible to have people get in, the people who need to get in to see a specialist get in to see them. So what we're doing, and we're going to talk about spread and scale later, is providing an opportunity for interested healthcare organizations and physicians and teams across the country to learn how they did it. And so that hopefully this becomes part of the movement that we hope will develops, inspired by your book, to make the changes so that our healthcare system truly functions.
I mean, I think these examples, there are so many of them, right, across the country. So race is a tremendous example. And we have a similar kind of program that's a partnership between downtown hospitals in Toronto based at Women's College called SCOPE, which I also talk about in the book, which is, again, very much about the premise that, so we used to talk about wrapping services around patients, which frankly, I don't know about you, but I never understood what that meant. You know, it's sort of a jargony thing, and very frequently, I think what it really was about was throwing more things at people, more, you know, coordinators, more phone numbers, more clinics for different body parts, just more stuff. Often very resource intensive, and often not very holistic. Instead of thinking about wrapping services around patients, what race and scope and these other examples that I talk about in the book actually do is they wrap the services around the primary care provider. So we double down on the investment in that important trusting relationship at the primary care level, and then we say to the patient or the citizen, you may not need to actually see a specialist. What we're going to do is allow your family doctor or nurse practitioner to speak to a specialist by phone or send a quick email and get a response within a week or you know, page the person who's on call for such and such a service and get advice or determine that what you need is to be seen by a specialist now, and we are going to commit to making sure that that happens so that you don't have to send your patient to the emergency department. So we have an imaging program at Women's College. We call 1-800-IMAGING, where if a family physician in our neighborhood sees a patient and they determine that person needs urgent medical imaging, I mean, what does a family doc or a GP do across the country? They send the patient to the emerge. What else are you gonna do? How else do you get a CT today for your patient? All roads lead to the emergency department, right? So instead, we have a phone number that the family physician or the, you know, PCP can call, and they get the phone is answered by a human, in this case a radiologist, and there can be a conversation with the primary care provider, and then the radiologist will say, yes, this person needs a CT, tell them to walk over now, and we will do it for them now, and then I will call you with the result. And so it's that human contact, that warm handover, and the ability to access the services immediately. And so what happens is over time, you begin to trust that if you've got a strong relationship between the citizen and their primary care team, and then you start to fix the relationships between primary care and the other parts of the system, where we understand that the role of the rest of the system as much as possible is to support that primary care team giving the best possible holistic care to the person, not putting everybody on a 6-month wait list to be seen, you know, in some outpatient clinic in some other location. That, I think, is the key to all of the successful reforms and the spread and scale initiatives that CFHI is involved in, whether it's Inspired or any of the other terrific examples, all build around that same principle. The problem is that if you don't happen to live in a community where something like that is implemented, then you don't get access to. That is the you know, so that's big idea 6 is spread and scale of successful projects across the country, which is obviously the core of the work of the Canadian Foundation for Healthcare Improvement. And I think probably one of the biggest challenges, if not the biggest challenge that we have.
Yeah, let's pick that up. When you mentioned the emergency department and all roads seem to lead there, one of the most interesting things when we look at the work that we have been involved in is that we can divert many who would have been on the road to the ED. Danielle mentioned Inspired. This is an approach that was developed in Halifax by Dr. Graham Rocker, borrowing and adapting from work that was done in Cambridge, UK, where people with advanced COPD are given the necessary supports at home, both to learn how to use their medication better, to learn how to use their oxygen better, and found that they could reduce by over 60% those breathless trips to emergency and admissions, which tend to be long, and COPD is apparently the most frequently. It's the condition that brings people into the hospital most frequently if they have a chronic healthcare condition. And so about 20 institutions across the country have taken up what Dr. Graham Rocker demonstrated, evaluated, had published in good journals results from. We seem to need a lot of proof to move anywhere in healthcare. He had it. We moved, and now we're working with the groups who adapted what he had done, and they all had similar results. We're providing an opportunity for them to spread that further, to move in the direction of scale. Now, scale is different than spread. Spread is when an idea is picked up, or we help it to be picked up, by a number of locations across the country so that teams have the benefit of interacting with teams from other provinces. As you know, in Canada, the provinces are the boundaries for healthcare. Many people never talk to people who are within the healthcare service provision of another province, and that's one of the real benefits of being part of one of these spread teams. Scale, on the other hand, is when a jurisdiction says, you know what, this idea is really good, and we're going to do what we can to make sure that everybody does this, whatever this is in their jurisdiction. And our best example of that right now is the reduction of inappropriate prescribing of antipsychotics. Canada, for people with dementia in long-term care, Canada is one of the world leaders in inappropriate prescribing in this area. And here's a case where we'd like to go down the scale. We don't want to be at the top. And we began first, it began first as a project that Cynthia Sinclair from Manitoba did as part of her EXTRA is a program which CFHI runs, which provides opportunities for teams who have something they really want to change in their institution that has not necessarily been tried out. This is not something that's a tested innovation. This is an idea. Anyway, Cynthia and Joe Punchniak showed that if you actually carefully assess the resident who was coming into your long-term care home, often using an approach developed in Ontario, the PCES approach to assessment, I never remember what it stands for, but basically is putting the person at the center and understanding who that person is, you do not need to automatically prescribe antipsychotics with the hope that they're going to be easy to dress, easy to move around, etc. Because, of course, mainly what happens is that people sit like stones, not particularly responsive, unable to feed themselves, etc. So what they showed was you can reduce and remove a lot of people from this who have been using these drugs inappropriately, which massively improves their quality of life, reduces their falls, turns out not to make them more aggressive. So we took that was the nodal point. 56 sites across the country adapted, learned from, implemented, and we got a rate of about 54% reduction or write-off antipsychotics. Then New Brunswick decided, well, this makes sense. They'd had such good results in one of their nursing homes that they decided to spread it, to scale it across the entire province. And we're in the midst of doing that with them now. And we are kind of lined up to do this with Newfoundland, PEI, and Quebec. So that is important. A jurisdiction decides, looking at something. So why isn't every jurisdiction moving on inspired? So what are the mechanisms? I'd love to hear from you. What are the mechanisms that make it routine that when there are tested and evaluated innovations in the way in which care is delivered, these all reduce rushes to the emergency department. What makes it so hard to take that next step?
So in the book, I talk about the notion of the anatomy of change. And I do harp on the difference between spread and scale because I do, as you've articulated very nicely, I do think that they're different. And there are some problems or solutions that are more amenable to the techniques of spread and others that are more amenable to the techniques of scale. And of course, very often you're going to need to use both, as you've just pointed out, but it's good to be clear about which techniques you're using for which purposes. And I talk about the need to have clarity about the alignment of the anatomic parts. I say, you know, in my public talks, you will not be very comforted about my clinical skills as a physician when I tell you that in my world, there are only three anatomic parts, the brain, the heart, and the feet. So with respect to the brain, what I'm talking about is the use of data, and specifically making data publicly available, because I actually think that we are way past the time when the concerns about making sure that the data are accurate and making sure that the data accurately reflect the complexity of giving care to different populations, all of which are very legitimate concerns, can be used as a shield to just not make the data available at all. So we're going to have to figure out how to collect the data that accurately measure and reflect the kinds of variations that you're describing. I mean, I want to know if my loved one is going into a nursing home that is using this approach to antipsychotics or not. I actually think I deserve to know if my loved one is going into, you know, what the rate of antipsychotic prescription is, or what the rate of cesarean section is, or what the rate of hysterectomy is in my local organization. And we can put caveats around those data and we can explain those data, but we cannot any longer, I think, fail to make them publicly available. So I think data is one driver, and that's what I mean when I refer to the brain. The second component of the anatomy of change that I talk about is the heart, of which, of course, is the poetic locus of courage. And we're going to need some of that. We're going to need it with our among our politicians, our elected officials, and among our system leaders. And I think the role of the public in this and the role of people like those of us in this room is to celebrate courage when we see it. Because some of the tough decisions that are evidence-informed about what are we going to pay for in our provincial programs, how are we going to align resources in ways that make sense, you know, people can take a real beating around some of those decisions. And if we don't rise up as a healthcare community to call out courage and good decision making based on evidence or informed by evidence when we see it, then it is going to be very hard for people to show it when it's needed. And the third part of the anatomy are the feet, and specifically what I talk about in the book are healthcare providers, most notably physicians, and the need for a new kind of professionalism in my own profession of medicine around the way that we see our role in the healthcare system and the way that we engage with the healthcare system as leaders and as participants in improving it. And I think only when all three of those body parts are aligned are we going to be able to see the kind of effective spread and scale that is required.
Fred Horn, who was the Minister of Health in Alberta a few ministers ago, said that everyone agrees that Canadian healthcare needs to be improved until they realize that it means you actually might have to change something. And that's why I think Danielle's point about courage is so important. If we go back in history, we can realize why we have the system we have today. It all had to do with the timing of an election in Saskatchewan at the beginning of the 60s. Tommy Douglas's government had worked away on the development of a comprehensive, integrated, team-based, find the cliche we all still use, approach to healthcare. And they were on their way towards this. All the doctors weren't that keen, but nonetheless, they cared about what kind of healthcare people had. But an election loomed. The cabinet looked at this and said, we're going to lose the whole thing. And so they said, we will just go with payment for healthcare services. And we know what happened after that. The doctors went on strike. They had to bring in Lord Stevens from the UK to help solve it. And the government agreed that healthcare would be left in the hands of the doctors. So who owns the mission of healthcare improvement now?
Well, of course, that's the million-dollar question. And I've been in enough meetings, and I'm sure everyone else has been, where people do this. That it's clear that depending on the day of the week, ownership is unclear. And so the unsatisfactory answer to the question has got to be all of us. That's the only possible answer, because there is no central authority that we can turn to and say, well, it's clearly the job of X to fix this. And there's a great piece, if you haven't read it, that you can Google about the problem of many hands in healthcare, which is not just a Canadian phenomenon, actually, but an international phenomenon, and certainly a problem as we're witnessing now south of the border. You want to see many hands. There is a whole other level of that distributed problem ownership, I think would be the way to put it, in the U.S. So the answer is nobody and therefore everybody, and which makes me come back to the reason why I've been approaching this project in the way that I have been approaching it, because I think so long as the ownership remains unclear and the public is unengaged, we're going to get a whole lot of not very much when it comes to healthcare improvement. It is, I think, the only way to overcome the problem of many hands is to have a clarity of demand on the part of citizens about what it is that they want to see. And that's why I am increasingly targeting my work to the public as opposed to the traditional kind of owners of these problems and solutions, because I think it's really hard. I mean, I am a system leader, I think, by any measure. You know, I'm a VP of a hospital, and it's hard. It's really hard to make change in complex health organizations, even when you're totally committed to it. And so it's only when the public is relentless in their demand for what it is that they want to see that we will our hands will be forced on some of this change. I don't think it can just kind of belong to the so-called leaders. We have to figure out how to broaden the movement and who are the other potential owners who can help us in that. And you and I have talked about this, Maureen. I mean, it's the general public, it's the regulatory colleges, it's the medical associations. There's some very interesting work happening in Saskatchewan between the SMA and the government right now around system improvement and system change. It's civil society organizations, it's not-for-profits, the third sector, all of this stuff. I think all of these groups are areas where we have not traditionally looked for health, for help in reforming healthcare, and I think that they are probably where the future is at.
But how do you put that together? I think that's the difficulty with saying that everybody needs to be involved. I would be interested in what people in this room think, because you are leaders in the healthcare system. Is it time as well to consider the expansion of what's defined as medically necessary services? You talked about the very sad case of the man who couldn't eat because his teeth were falling out, and he couldn't pay for a dentist. Going back again to what was envisaged in Saskatchewan, they didn't envisage that there still would not be dental care or no pharma care, or people have to pay if they're not the lucky 70% with an employer-based plan for physiotherapy. They didn't envisage that. That was meant to come afterwards. So how do we get there? I don't think that keeping as the basis of universal health care in Canada, which isn't universal, far less universal than most European countries, doctors and hospitals, and if you're lucky, an employer-based plan to cover the others, is really going to get us the efficiencies that we need in order to provide better care.
So this is where we're coming to all of you, because I think, you know, we can start a conversation about big ideas, you know, in Canadian healthcare, and I think I'm not the only person that's been trying to start that conversation. CFHI, lots of groups are out there trying to get the public engaged, but, you know, it comes back to the Nurses Book Club. Like, what are we going to do to move from the conversation to the actual change? I mean, we've been saying we need pharmacare in this country for 60 years. You know, we're going to say it for 60 more unless something shifts. So what does that shift look like, and how can we move from the conversation about the big ideas to their actual implementation? So our intention is actually, because of course there is no single answer to this question, for us to stop now and to open this conversation to all of you. And please identify yourselves just so people have a sense of who you are when you offer your views.
Hi, my name is Penny Pausha, and I have a company, Instincts at Work. I do neuroscience-based change management and leadership coaching in the health industry. I work primarily, a good deal with physicians. I've done a lot of health links work around the province. In answer to that question, it is complex, and what I see at the base of it is that we have an industrial mindset, and we're trying to deal with complexity in a way that we haven't upgraded our mental operating system to do so. So when I look at change management, it's a lot about how people deal with threat and how they deal with planning, going back to planning and trying to create certainty, where when we're trying to make some of these changes, we can't predict actually how things are going to look down the road, even in a few months of implementation of something. And so what I specialize in is trying to help people to upgrade how they think in order to be able to manage in that. And so a great example when you talk about how do we do it on the front lines, and I've taken a lot of what you said, Danielle, around community development work, and that's actually my background way back when in CHC was community development work. So in the Huron-Perth region, in the health link there, we've looked at bringing frontline providers together to try to solve some of these problems. But when we understand the brain science and how people resist change, it gives us a really good window into why change doesn't happen. And it really has a lot to do with what we know quite well about habit formation. So just one little story about that is that there was an eMERGE group in one of the hospitals. They knew that there was issues with sort of patients, cycling through the eMERGE. And we sort of challenged them with like, okay, what else can we do about this? And as part of HealthLinks, they were gonna do a coordinated care plan and bring a group of providers and physicians around to have meetings to see how they could better serve these patient goals. And the nursing staff were like, we don't have time, we can't do coordinated care plan, there's all this admin, and so the leader who had been through the program was trying to think about it differently. She said, what if we have a family meeting? Oh, yeah, we can do a family meeting. What does that tell us about the brain? It's like familiarity, and then doing slight tweaks on what's already known allows people to feel empowered and be able to make those changes. And it's a very simple idea, but I can't tell you how powerful it is and how much you're able to leverage those kinds of things. So we come up with these great ideas and these complex ways of doing things, and I've seen it in HealthLinks around the province, around all these systems and administration, but people just don't have the capacity. They don't have the brain capacity to act on it. They're in overwhelm and there's too much complexity. So the simplifying it and teaching leaders how to communicate about that and simplify it has been something that I've seen that's been very, very successful in bringing people around to make those small changes that they can then amplify. But it really starts with, back to the brain, how we're thinking about it. So that's something I wanted to share in terms of my experiences.
Thank you. And just to say about that this is something that sounds very familiar to me as a physician, because when I look at my specialist colleagues, for example, excuse me, many of whom have very long wait lists and who really experience any criticism of a long wait time as a personal kind of critique, because they will say, and they are right, I am working as hard as I can. You know, I come in early in the morning, I stay until late at night. If a family doctor calls me and begs me to see somebody quickly, I fit them into my clinic, I run 2 hours late, I'm doing my charts when I get home at night. Like, I'm working as hard as I can. What do you want from, it's not my fault that my wait list is 2 years long. But so to say to that person, well, what you need to do is actually go in and look at your calendar for the next 3 months and figure out, can we reduce your follow-up time from 3 months to 6 months for 2/3 of these patients? How many could be discharged back to their primary care provider? How many could you do as a phone call instead of a face-to-face consult? And you just see them, start to sink in their chairs, because it just feels like more on top of what they're already doing. And so I think that you're right, that reframing things around tweaks to what you're already doing that can save you time in your day and your life, as opposed to the pile-on of the broadening of your job description, is really important for people's willingness to participate in change, particularly when we're dealing with physicians who are not employed in the healthcare system and you've got no other leverage other than goodwill very frequently to make this stuff happen.
But race and base show that when you change the system, you can indeed make improvements.
Absolutely.
whichever. Hi. Sorry. Switched here.
My name's Hillary Salter, and I run a small consulting practice working directly with family physicians in their clinics and in their offices. Essentially, it's a practice management program. It started off with supporting physicians moving into family health organizations. And the crux of the work I'm doing is really the shift from basically encounter-based care to population-based care. I think one of the, I guess, differences is that I work one-on-one with family physicians. I'm sort of the opposite end of the system leader. I'm in the trenches. And completely appreciating what you're saying about just one little thing, and you just feel like your client will crumble. Back to your question, I think that one of the groups of citizens to engage is the Nurses Book Club. I go back to, so my previous incarnation is in community development for cooperative housing. And one of the realities there is that our elders are often the ones who are just ready to rabble-rouse, you know, and they really don't give a hoot about what anybody is thinking about this anymore. And I've seen some amazing organizing. We also live in a community where generally we write them off.
Right.
And yet they are a phenomenal source of you know, time, energy. A union organizer I knew just once said that the scariest thing he knew was a group of 80-year-old women with a mission. Seriously.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, so I'm looking at that and thinking from a perspective of you've got a group of people who will not be overwhelmed. My mom, who's 88, is involved with the East, I'm sorry, I still call it East General, East York Hospital, in a similar way. And they've got the time. I sort of think the early suffragettes were over 40. I mean, that's not old anymore. But I think that's one area. I think that's one area that, again, there's a huge group of energy, experience, and willingness that is ready to be tapped into.
So I think it's a great point, and I will say I went to do a session in Collingwood before the book came out, actually, for one of these lifelong learning institutes, which are sort of networks of retirees that exist across the province and the country for people who are retired but still want to engage in ideas and stuff. And I went out to Collingwood and I thought, oh, you know, I'm going to do another speech. 400 seniors came to my talk in Collingwood, and they were engaged the whole time. And, you know, so again, it comes back to this question of what should I be asking those people to do? Because actually they would be willing to do something. And right now we've got me up on the stage like I'm the expert telling them everything that they need to know about the healthcare system. Like, I think the balance of power there is all wrong. I should be there asking them for their help, but I don't yet have clarity about what it is I should be asking for.
Hi, Reza Deber, University of Toronto. I love your book, and this is as a sort of nuance as opposed to a district. But in my experience, one size does not fit all. There is a lot of change happening at the individual provider level, and the sorts of systems changes that you want, if you don't measure it properly, can make things worse. And an example that I've got actually in the book I've got coming out at the end of the year is
which I look forward to reading.
All right, people can advertise. That's
fine. Oh yeah,
fine.
But is a person who's a judge in England and was furious because when they put in their wait time thing, she couldn't call up and make an appointment with her doctor at a time of her own convenience because they would flunk the wait time standards. So they had the thing that you had to call same day and see if you could fit in, and there was no way that would work with her schedule. And they changed it, but the initial wait time standards did not make a whole lot of sense. So what I'm wondering is, do you see any ways of getting at the low-hanging fruit in the, which you have in your book, More is Not Always Better, and figuring out how you can save money by not giving inappropriate care that would make, you know, cost a lot of money, make things worse? And are there some mechanisms you can think of to stop the AstroTurf groups from pushing for reform always means pay for the newest drug by the drug company at whatever they want to charge?
Just Choosing Wisely, as many of you in this room would know, has taken that on as its mission. And I think the mission being end inappropriate care, reduce inappropriate care, but I do think that we come back to the problem we come to often, which is there isn't any actual management structure around that. You know, Wendy Levinson and Karen Bourne and their colleagues have lots of energy, and specialist groups have done a great job of adapting what the Institute of Medicine in the States has done, but there isn't anybody out there saying, and by the way, you have to do this. It's not like Kaiser Permanente, when they get on an improvement journey, it's voluntary up until about 80% take-up, and after that they say, well, actually, you won't be paid if you don't do it this way. So how do we get around this lack of leverage?
Well, I actually think, I talk about this idea of, I call it don't just do something, stand there, right? So less inappropriate, harmful, and low-value tests and procedures. But the question is, if not inappropriate tests and procedures, then what? Because actually, very often, both physicians, in my experience, and patients are using inappropriate, low-value care as a means of coping with uncertainty and anxiety about not feeling well. And actually, anxiety and uncertainty are hard. Like, they are really hard things to live in. And so I think that, you know, I am a huge proponent of the Choosing Wisely campaign. I have done, you know, and will continue to do everything that I can to support that work, because I think it's very important. And I do think that it is shifting culture. But, you know, in talking to people across the country, people say to me, well, you know, what am I supposed to do? Like, I'm in pain. So what am I supposed to do? I went to see my doctor. They said, you don't need an MRI. I left, you know, bereft both of a plan and an MRI requisition. That's not, you know, that's not care. And so I think actually it does come back, and I don't mean to harp on this too much, but I think it's really important that we acknowledge that we have to have something else instead of the low-value, inappropriate, harmful, wasteful care. And the answer to that is relationships. And it's not relationships with a neurosurgeon. It's relationships with your primary care, usually doctor, right? And so because when I hear from my family physician who's known me since I was 12 and who I know cares about me and who I trust, you know, you don't need this and in fact it could hurt you, let's wait 2 weeks, go to physio or whatever, that is a completely different conversation and interaction than feeling like I've walked up against a brick wall of the government is trying to save money. And I think that is really important to the public success of Choosing Wisely and other like campaigns, is understanding that the hardest thing that there is in terms of health is living with uncertainty, and we have to have alternatives that we can present to people, ideally that are publicly funded, you know, as opposed to just saying, well, the answer is no, because what you think you are asking for, or what I thought was a good idea for you, is a bad idea, it's going to hurt you, and therefore the answer is we're just going to do nothing. The perception of, Wendy Levinson taught me this actually, the perception that not doing inappropriate care is doing nothing will kill us, because will kill us, and you will kill the movement, right, for appropriateness, because it's not doing nothing, it's not doing the harmful things and instead doing things that are helpful. So we need to think, I think, deeply about that conversation.
Any more questions? Are there any more questions?
Yes, over here.
Genevieve Obarski from the Change Foundation. I think your point about creating time for relationships is really important. We did a year of talking to healthcare providers, physicians, pharmacists, personal support workers, et cetera, about what gets in the way of having different relationships with family caregivers. And they all recognize the importance of it, but to a person almost said, the system we work in does not allow that to happen. And in fact, sometimes there's disincentives to spend time on that, but they want to do it. So I think the challenge is to find places where we can work with leaders that can create the system that allow people to build those relationships so that they aren't, you know, people aren't bringing their loved ones to the eMERGE for respite care. And the physicians we talked to in rural Ontario up north again said, we see the relief in families' eyes when they tell us, when we tell them their family member's gonna be admitted. And they know that's not an appropriate use of healthcare resources, but they don't feel like they have a system built to allow them the opportunity. So I think the challenge is to build systems so that providers can do what they know is right to foster those relationships and have a more holistic relationship.
I want to just go back to the movement, because I think that this is the most interesting thing of the many interesting things in your book, Danielle. And that is, how do we really broaden out beyond the nurses' book clubs, beyond the retirement, the groups of retirees, et cetera, et cetera? I want to know, is there anybody in this room who is with a community health center? That's too bad, because community health centers have boards. They have community boards. They could be nodal points for launching discussions of where healthcare improvement in Canada could go. And of course, community health centers were, as an institution, devoted to integrating care, to linking with the community, to providing primary care, bringing in the, as we call them, the allied health professions. They had a very difficult start. Again, going back to the 50s in Saskatchewan, they were going to be the heart of a new healthcare system, but were stomped on, basically, and didn't get off the ground. But this reconnection to the community, in a way, is really our defense against inappropriate privatization in Canadian healthcare.
And I think the other thing is that institutions, I mean, I have thought a lot, obviously, because I work in a hospital, about what is the role of any individual healthcare organization in advocating for public policy change, you know, which is really, I mean, I would never publicly call my book a public policy book because nobody would buy it, but that's really... But that's really what it is. It's a book about changing public policy, right? And so what, you know, what am I doing as a hospital VP, you know, traipsing about the country arguing for change in public policy? You know, it's only because I work in a hospital that views its role as an advocacy organization for system improvement that I have had the luxury of being permitted to do that, right? And so, you know, whether it's the community health center, whether it's the hospital, whether it's the, you know, corporations or organizations that each of you works for, I think, you know, there's the thing about, well, you can do the change by making it real locally, right? You can be a role model. You can be the change you want to see. You can try to do that, and that's good. But I think the other thing is acknowledging that every organization has an obligation to push for the broader changes that we need to see in the healthcare system, and not the ones that will benefit us financially or whatever, but the ones that are actually about the public good. And sometimes that's, like, I don't actually think we have a great tradition of healthcare organizations and institutions in this country coming together to say, you know, we better address poverty, otherwise the so-called high users are going to remain high users because the social determinants of health are basically written across the forehead of every high user in our community. So those are the kinds of conversations that I think we haven't evolved to the point of being able to have.
No, but we'll have to if we're going to see the change that we want to.
It's 8:59. I see Matthew Hart walking across the stage.
We do have 1 minute.
Hi, my name is Brent McGaw from Canada Health Infoway. I guess just to answer that question, Maureen, about how we could perhaps try to expand and engage with Canadians more, one of the things that Infoway has been working on with a whole bunch of other partners, I'm actually just seeing Sheila now, she should probably be saying this, not me, but is the Better Health Together campaign, which has really engaged every province and territory across the country. Lots of the, you know, I think all of the medical associations across the country, and really with an intent of trying to engage Canadians around this question about how do we make healthcare better. So it just may be a plug for that, and maybe it's an opportunity to try to use that as a platform to build amongst many stakeholders. This isn't just InfoWay, this is just something that we're working on with a whole bunch of other partners to try to further this dialogue.
Danielle will be able to share all of those emails with your platform, and we'll thicken it across the country.
Danielle and Maureen, thank you very much. Our next Breakfast with the Chiefs is April 24th with Dr. Peter Pisters from UHN. It is partnered with the HEROC, so it will be at the HEROC conference. Thank you, and have a good morning.